as a light that slowly crawls upon the floor. So I know you're inside waiting with your dream thoughts contemplating all the love you're incubating deep within your body's core. All the rituals so involving and my mental taste dissolving, I come to you once more. You can know my body, but you never know my soul. You can know my arms, my legs, my thighs. You can hear my moans, you can hear my cries, but you ain't never gonna know my soul. Yes, you can know my body, but you will never know my soul. You can know my arms, my legs, my thighs. You can hear my bones, you can hear my cries. Child, you ain't never gonna know my soul.
Computer love affair would have you any other would want you so badly. You like doing things that you like to do, and you know them. They're all around you. You like the standard games that participate your soul, and you think that it's found you. And you like your parties, and you like your theater, and you like to sit and talk your shop for hours and hours until later. You can say the intellectuals assume that they make your mind jump just like computer wires, and they run along the line. I only gave you my mind. I only gave you my love. Houses, rooms to shelter you. Cars to get you around, not one but two. And your little darlings will have the best school. And you couldn't come with me, for that would break the rules. And you love what you think you should love. Any computer would love you, any mind that ever, 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 ever. I only gave you my love. I only gave you my mind. Any computer lover would find you are so lovable. Not mine. Happy parties, happy social life, happy giving yourself the name of being his wife. You win, 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 you win.
I only gave you my soul. I only gave you my heart. I only gave you the stars. I only gave you what I could give. I only gave you what I could live. Any computer lover would love you until they turn the electricity.
Feeling my luck is mighty green. I go down to have a cup of coffee and see if my luck might change. Look up over my coffee. I want to tell you the truth. What it feels like to see a pretty dark haired little girl, pretty blue eyes looking right back at you. No mistake, you gotta make it. To the outskirts of town, my thumb up in her eyes looking down. Long comes a convertible, long blonde hair driving that thing. Hop on in, the two of you, I hear the prettiest little bird boy sing. It's her and me, and now there's she, and that makes three. But a car won't stop. And we're digging on each other too much, too much. Yeah, we can't part. We're by the roadside again. Her and me, you and she, all three. After a while, two more chicks come along, just got out of the movie house. Hop on in, says one, we do. I watch the reckless style she cries. She says, don't you know we love you, baby? The love comes through here in five. We're rolling on down the road, get to the outskirts of town, up on the cliff side where we look down, hugging and kissing, touching all the way. I look up and see something. I can't believe my eyes. A brunette and a redhead must have jumped their guys. Oh, and join us, we say. And they say, it's only a song. Thank you.
see. Tell me about your love, baby touch.
Well, look at her. I see good morning, baby. Good morning, baby. She look at me and she's kind of grinning with her eyes. She says, good morning, daddy. She reaches out and she talks to me through touch. I say, good morning to you, baby. She kind of yawns with her sleepy eyes. I said, say good morning to the dream prince. I dream of you, Liz.
Floor. like railroads. We've laid so many tracks behind. Stand here on this corner much longer. Sooner or later I'll get tired. Then I'll close my eyes.
Sometimes on the pillow, I would sit there and I would feel her She would just lay there beside me and we'd talk sometimes, we'd talk. See, I had a, a rough childhood. It's not rough, no, I mean, not money, it was just something about it was hers and the mother's and all. I couldn't find out what it was. Who is she now?
I love you.
If I stand here just a little bit longer, maybe she'll appear, and I think she's real, and I'll think she's real. And I think she's real. Oh.
Boy, heard he was just born. Sure enough.
No, he haven't.
But he's there. Name on the crib, in the hospital, by the bed. The tub tag. William R. Strickland.
Who's that?
That's me! That's me! That's me! That's me!
Grew up to be a young man. My father said, stupid dolt, don't you remember anything? I grew up to be a young man. Fall out of school, can't get any of his things in his head. That boy's not for this world. I grew up into a young man.
Sitting here, getting high, looking who is me.
That's I. Then mother comes in and she has something in her hand and it says, son, you must now leave. You are on your own. So I look inside of my face, glance into the mirror, take one glance and see my name.
I shall give myself to the people. I shall let them decide. I shall let them tell me who I am. I shall not hide. My name is William R. Strickland. Give me Strickland or give me a mirror. Oh, a mirror. That's what I want. A mirror. A mirror. A mirror. A mirror. A mirror. A mirror. A mirror.
Don't anybody believe me.
Don't anybody wanna hear me.
I'm just a name. I'm just a name. I'm just William R.
Strickland.
William R. Strickland. That's, me.
Classified ads on Sunday morning. What kind of job can I get? Thumbing through my old lady is riding me with nothing yet.
See, there's a worker for an engineer, college 8 years.
I ain't even graduated from high school, there's my tears. About midway down the column, now it seems to appear. Says Rand Corporation's gonna have a war game this year.
Soldiers of fortune, soldiers of dread, soldiers who can't get the war.
So I went down to the corporation. I filed out my long files. They looked into
computers and they began to turn the dials. A whiz and a whop and a zing-zop do it, and that was about all she wrote. They said, "You are a young warrior, all the burdens you tote." This nice young representative, he came to me. He looked all over my body for things I don't know what he could see. He said, "You're a perfect specimen." I looked him in the eye. He said, "You're a young warrior and you don't have to die." I reported. My drill sergeant, I understand, had a PhD in nothing other than Hindu philosophy. Talked about the layman, the shaman sitting on nails. Disbarred the Orient for believing not in the hell. So I looked him in the eye, and slow as a snail I began to sigh. "Please do tell." "The war is not like other wars. Number one, you are to wear a badge. Sensitive to molecular electricity. You will have a pack, a warming device to wear in the Antarctic. We have closed circuit TV from every country that will be watching. Please do not be a ham. Do not be a ham." So I looked him in the eye and I said, "Mr. Drill Sergeant," I said, "I sure am thankful that I got this job." I said, "My wife, she says, none of that, please." Well, we went on into the war, or at least we started the preparations. And here I was on the front with these other buddies, see. Their mothers, they'd already been sending them care packages. I hadn't had no care packages because my wife, she couldn't cook very good anyhow. And pretty soon I was beginning to eat every other care package that the other boys got. And we're standing there, and I asked one fella up to me, his name was Eugene. I says, "Eugene, what?" That's what I said to him. I said, "Eugene," he said, "what?" "Eugene," he said, "what? You get it, don't you?" Anyway, I said, "Eugene," he said, "what?" I said, "What do you think this here war's about?" And he said, "Well, as far as I can figure, what it is they figured out in the world that there's been too many fleshial deaths or something like that. And what we gotta do is we gotta stop this and we gotta find exactly which way it's going, because you gotta have direction. You gotta harness your power, you understand? I mean, if Edison hadn't have shown that way, we'd have never had harnessed power." And my drill sergeant, he come up and says, "Boys," he says, "now what we're gonna do is maneuverable tactics under R23 section 102. You're all paid sergeants, and you are perpetrators of the Nevermore." "Oh, please, Mr. Sergeant, would you please clarify that if you don't mind?" "What I want to say to you boys is none of you is going to get killed. What you got to do is you got to take these electric guns, you see, and you got to point them at the enemy whenever you see the enemy. Now, Charles Reichert over here, he's going to be your napalm, fellow boy." "Hi, Charles." "Hi, Eugene." "Hi, Ed. That was my name, Ed." So he said hello to all of us, and he showed us his electrical napalm. Oh, it was a real gas, I want to tell you. So what we had to do, see, according to this here drill sergeant, is we had to penetrate behind the enemy lines. And it was some other country, and we weren't to know what other country it was, but they were all into the computer game themselves, and they'd all read the classified ads in their country, wherever it was. And the object we was going to do on closed circuit TV, and he said, "If you don't be a ham, there's just a possibility that TC Fox and MGM Lion might just want to buy this property." Well, that just heightened our heads right up, you know where. So here we were, getting letters from mothers, except for me, and I had a wife, and as I told you, she couldn't cook. And we'd come out to the front lines, and there's all this boom, you know, that kind of sound, and everybody's beginning to buzz and shoot around there.
And what they told me was, they said, you are on the honor system, and if your electrical thing gets hit, what you have to do is you have to step off onto home base, is what they call it. Not stepping somewhere outside. Home base, it wasn't really home back home, but it was home base in the army. So we step over there. Well, anyway, pretty soon as this whole war began to come on, and all this buzz that I was telling you about begins to happen. And we're going to town, man, and the drill sergeant, he's over there saying, go to the left, go to the right, shoot over here, shoot up tight. And the napalm guy, the guy I was telling you about, boy, he was just blasting everybody, you know. And pretty soon you see all these colored lights, psychedelic as heck. And they just pouring all over the place, and everybody's getting kind of stoned watching them, you know. But we were soldiers, we were getting paid for it, we liked it, you know. So we didn't get told too much, because that's for those hypocritical civilians back home. Because you see, I wasn't a civilian anymore, now I'm a soldier, and that's what I was proud about. That's what I wrote my wife about the other day, isn't it? Well, anyway, here we are, and all this stuff is going around, and pretty soon, my electrical impulse device shoots my flag up. Well, anyway, I looked and I wanted to keep going on because it was so much fun. I mean, war is a good time. But they said, no, son, you got to step out to home base. I said, no, I just started this thing. I don't want to end it yet, you know. I'm sorry, son, you have to step out to home base. So anyway, I figured if I had to go down, I just couldn't step over there. I mean, there's something that's left out whenever you just have an electrical war. I mean, there's just something that's too groovy about a real flesh tearing up, rip your jaws off your face, destroy your body, have your intestines pouring out over the ground, have your feet slapped off your body type of a war, which is kind of a groove, you see. But anyway, they hit my electrical impulse thing. Me realizing the television set was on, my wife, she just might be home watching it, just in case TC Fox or MG Lyon happened to be getting the prices right and settling on the bid. Well, I started gasping and I started falling and I started coming over this way and I started coming over that way and I go choke, choke, and I begin to fall to the ground. And then the chaplain, I mean, they even had an electronic computer chaplain, he comes over there and he says, I now pronounces this here boy laying on the ground with his electronic computer device throwing its yellow flag up there. I now pronounces him dead. Give you third right and amen. And that was just about it. But I didn't want to quit. Anyway, they returned me back to the corporation where they had the war games going. And I was sitting in there, there's a lot of other boys had to go back to home base, and they was all over there. And they were all sitting there, we were all talking, just shooting the bull, you know, because we learned how to shoot the bull. There ain't nothing better than being a soldier and shooting the bull. Friends, I want to tell you, if you ever want to join, you want to shoot the bull too. But anyway, this here fella says, the President of the United States of SSRUSMGAT or something like that is going to come in here and talk to you boys. Long will this country remember what you have done. Long, long countries remember what you have done. You are the sacred soldiers, boldly fighting boldly fighting for. Anyway, see, I'm back here and I'm reading the classified ads. I'm trying to look around and see if there's anything I can get a job, unless some masonry job, but I never had the strength to lift bricks anyway. My wife, she's just as mad at me as ever was. But I tell you, one day, what's gonna happen to me is I'm gonna be watching myself on TV, and I'm gonna see that beautiful thing. Just me and my country, just me and my second. And all I can say is you're red or you're white or you're green or you're blue. Either Uncle Sam or the Russians or somebody's gonna want you.